Hello, my name is Dr. Maria Weber. I am Assistant Professor of Physics and Director of the Wiley Planetarium at Delta State University. This video is to give you an overview of the poster that I would have presented at the International Planetarium Society conference this summer, entitled STEM Education and the Rural Planetarium. Cleveland, Mississippi and Delta State University are located in the middle of the Mississippi Delta. Now, the Mississippi Delta is this region outlined in green between the Mississippi and the Yazoo rivers. And here we have Cleveland right in the middle there. Now, STEM education in the Mississippi Delta is really at a critical juncture. All across the United States, but in particular in the Delta, the number of science teachers is dwindling. And in our local region, schools absolutely do not have adequate resources to engage students in STEM activities. But at Delta State University, we have an incredibly important STEM resource for the Mississippi Delta region, the Wiley Planetarium. And the Wiley Planetarium was built in 1976. It was remodeled in 2016, and we can seat 60 people. In our planetarium, we welcome members of the public for our shows, as well as a number of school groups. And I also use it to teach my Physics 105 astronomy class, and it's a gen ed class with about 50 students every semester. The Wiley Planetarium is one of only three planetariums in Mississippi, and it is the only planetarium in Mississippi at a university. I really see our rural planetarium best utilized as a classroom. I find that it is easier to get schools to visit us if we can directly link what the students see in our planetarium shows and in the content that I will present to them. If we can link that content to their state standards, to outcomes that they can measure. So in our case, those outcomes for the state are determined by the Mississippi College and Career Readiness Standards of Science. So here are a few examples of those state standards and how I have linked them with planetarium content. In high school, students must compare and contrast celestial bodies, easy to do in the planetarium, study the motion of objects in our solar system. And I was really excited to see that this is on the state standards for Mississippi. The students must build an analemma calendar. You couldn't find a better tool to help build an analemma calendar than the planetarium. So we can walk through this lab together. Now, before the pandemic shut us down in mid-March, I wasn't able to get high school students through to do an analemma lab, but I was able to get my University Physics 105 students through to do an analemma lab. And I'm going to talk about that lab in particular here. So the analemma lab that I did with my Physics 105 students at Delta State, I titled it, the theme of the night was Keeping Time. And so we had a little mini lecture portion. Our final activity for the night, sort of a capstone to absorb all that information that they learned, was to create an analemma calendar for us in Cleveland, Mississippi. So this is what the students would have seen in our planetarium. We have an Evans and Sutherland Digistar 6 system. But here I had the students facing south, and I put up the altitude and azimuth coordinate system. And I started on that day, which was in late February. I put the sun in the sky around noontime, and then I stepped through the sun's position every day during the course of the year at noontime, and they saw how the sun changed position in the sky. I didn't put the trail tracker on there, so they didn't really know that the analemma was going to look like a figure eight pattern to begin with. They sort of discovered that as they were doing the lab, which is a really cool thing, I think, that we can do in the planetarium. So I gave the students a chart, a table, and they recorded the altitude and azimuth of the sun at noon during the day on selected dates. I didn't make them do it for every day of the year, using what I called naked eye observations in the planetarium. So I put up what you're seeing right here and didn't give students any more information other than here they had marked some altitude and azimuth lines, and they essentially had to estimate based on that where the sun was in the sky. And of course, that gets a little bit harder when you get up here towards zenith. And then the students then took those positions that they recorded in their table and used those to plot the altitude and azimuth positions to create their analemma calendar. There were some really great analemma calendars, about five of them that I'm showing you here. So here you can see this is the chart that they filled out with their altitude and azimuth of the sun estimations. And then they plotted it here on this chart, altitude, vertical, azimuth on the horizontal axis. And I asked them to label the positions, not all of them labeled all the positions, but generally we get a sense for the fact that the summer solstice is at the highest altitude, the winter solstice is at the lowest altitude. And I asked them to sort of trace the path that the sun would take in the sky during the course of the year, and generally they got it right, that we that the sun decreases in altitude as you get towards the winter solstice, increases as you get towards the summer solstice. The majority of students did a really good job of sort of capturing this two-lobe analemma shape, which I thought was really exciting considering they didn't really give them any indication before we got into the lab of what the analemma should really look like. And they also, most of them, captured the analemma's slight tilt eastward that we have for our location in Cleveland, Mississippi. And so some of the students went from more of a straight line approach to connecting the dots, and some of them did a more sort of sweeping approximation between the dots. At Delta State, our Physics 105 class is a gen ed class, and I'm having mostly freshmen come through, students who aren't science majors, students who maybe haven't had a math course since algebra or trigonometry. So I think that the outcomes that we'll see if we compare the labs between high school students and my college students probably won't be too terribly different. And at the moment, we are planning on having small group classes for my Physics 105 class this fall. Small group again means about 9 students. I'm going to have to do 6 of these small group classes during the course of the semester each week to get my students through their astronomy lab sections. But, you know, that's our plan for now. Who knows what will happen as we progress through the semester. So this got me thinking about what we might need to do if we have to push this lab online in the future at some point during the course of the fall semester. We can absolutely have students build an analemma calendar with the web browser version of Stellarium, in which case students would be in charge of progressing through the sun's daily motion or daily position on their own. And so here's an example of what the students would see in Stellarium with the free online web version. So we have them face south. They can turn off the atmosphere so they can see the sun in the daytime against the background stars. They can control the date and time down here. They can fix their position on the globe. And then we can put on the coordinate system or altitude azimuth coordinate system and have them step through daily at the same time to make their analemma. And actually, it's maybe a little bit easier in this way for the students because they don't have to estimate the position of altitude and azimuth. They can click on the sun and Stellarium will tell them the exact altitude and azimuth at that time, date, and location. And I plan to use the outcome of their lab report grades to help track the comparison between what students are really learning with me in person in the planetarium and what they can learn at home doing these similar labs on their own with Stellarium. And it's really important for me, for students, if they're going to do distance learning, especially my students at Delta State, to have access to free or relatively cheap online tools, because my students are often coming from economically underprivileged backgrounds. If you have any questions, comments, or want to share with me similar things that you're doing in your planetarium and your thoughts on that, please contact me. My email address is mweber@deltastate.edu. This is beginning of my second year as a planetarium director, and I hope to learn much, much more through my involvement in the International Planetarium Society.